Thanks to Nielsen for having us and me in this morning to talk about this really great topic. I just want to build on what Megan said this morning, which I think was a really great primer for what we're going to talk about. At AdWeek, we agree. We think this is the most interesting time in the media and marketing space that we can remember. In the past 2 years, I think that we're seeing a real resurgence of creative thinking around brand marketing and the customer journey. Maybe 3 years ago, people were fetishized about the disruption that was happening around brands. We're seeing people move past that, from the most technologically savvy company to a CPG company who's just getting started. People are trying things. So for us, it's a generational story. It's a 100-year story, and it's the story of a customer revolution. And I think that our panelists are in the same boat, and I've talked to them before the panel, and they all agree, I think, that this is a very interesting time to be talking about data and creativity. So with that, we'll get started. So panelists, please introduce yourselves, and then we'll get going.
Okay. So I'm Kavita Vazirani. I head up Insights and Measurement at NBCU. I've been there for about 9 months. Prior to that, I was at Comcast as a marketer for 20 years.
That's great. Hi, Peter McGinnis, Chief Marketing and Commercial Officer at Chobani.
Hi, guys. Radha Subramaniam. I am the Chief Research and Analytics Officer for CBS, and I've been at NBC, I've been at Viacom, I've been at Yahoo, I've been at Nielsen, iHeart, so kind of done all aspects of media.
Hi, I'm Ravi Dar, Professor of Marketing at Yale. I was brought onto this panel to grade this as this week. I'm also the Director of the Yale Center for Customer Insights. We work with a large number of Fortune 100 companies. Looking at, you know, what keeps you up at night, but what also gets you up in the morning to go to work. So it's kind of fun to be on this panel with this team here.
So let's start with the loyalty question. How has your definition of customer loyalty and engagement evolved in the last, say, 18 months?
Yeah, so I'm going to put my marketer hat on for a minute. I think there are really three things that I thought about. It's no longer about reward points and how based on how much you spend. It was really about what I call the three P's of partnerships. You know, partnerships, purpose, and personalization. So partnerships, it's really brands are making strategic connections with other brands. So as an example, Xfinity partnered with iHeartRadio, partnered with YouTube, partnered with Netflix to provide a different experience. And it was a way of extending the value of the Xfinity brand. I think brands are partnering with influencers. Brands are partnering with other brands to build a more unique proposition and connecting with customers. The other one, purpose. You know, how many of you have seen ads now that incorporate people with different abilities? I think that's important. People care about that, and people are loyal buyers of that. And then, you know, last but not least, personalization. We all want something that is going to be relevant for us in a very unique way so that we can engage with a brand differently. So I think loyal, all of those things combined is changing how we think about loyalty.
Kind of how we look at it, Chobani, it may not be for everyone, is we have kind of these avid, rabid fans called Chobaniacs, and they're actually very few, but they're highly mobilized and vocal, and they buy a lot of yogurt, and they've fueled a lot of growth, but pretty small population. And so they're very important to us, and we have a direct dialogue with them, but I don't think that's the way to look at loyalty, I think. So if you back it up, the way we look at it is, do you like us? We're a purpose-based brand. So beyond those Chobaniacs, we have a lot of people that like what we do, whether it be community work, whether it be philanthropic work, whether it be refugee work, and they convert at different times. They may not even like yogurt, or they may be light users of yogurt, but they like us a lot as a brand, and they dip in and out of the yogurt market. So I think just to look at that core historical conventional wisdom pie of those people that buy you the most, I think is kind of short-sighted. And I think it'll dry up eventually. So it's really about broadening your appeal and getting more people to like the company and what you stand for. And they'll convert at some point. So kind of having one foot in the present, one foot in the future.
It's about purpose. It's about likability, it's about personalization, it's about partnerships 100%. But what keeps me up at night now is the whole question of trust, right? Because trust in institutions, trust in government, trust in people keeping your data safe. I mean, that if there's a crisis of our times in this industry, it is around that. And I think we ignore that at our peril as brands, because we are custodians. We are custodians of culture, as Megan so eloquently said this morning. We're custodians of, you know, values, but we are custodians of people's data. And I think whether you're a small brand or a large brand, you have to be really, really cognizant and aware of that.
I'm not a big fan of liking, by the way. I think there's a lot of stuff going on which, on the metrics around liking, you know, leads to engagement. I want to look at behavior. In fact, most of the companies we're working with, we're trying to push in them. It's okay to look at intermediate measures like engagement of liking, sharing, and so forth. But unless you tie it down to behavior, it's not particularly useful. So the way the loyalty for me has changed, if you look at three things that drive behavior historically, it's one is your prior experience. Last time I bought a Toyota, I was pretty happy with it. So when I buy a new car, I kind of look at Toyota and similar things, so I narrow it down. So one is your prior experience. The second is what you guys in the room do, which is branding. Like, what does the brand speak to me? Is it the brand about me? And the third is what's been happening in the last 10 years is the word of mouth. What do others think about this, right? So in the earlier days, before the internet, what others think about it was literally the people I knew close to me. Now it's what others, 6 million or 60 million or 600 million people think about it. So if you look at fundamentally how marketing has changed, is really my prior experience has become a small part of what do I buy next. Yes, I'm pretty happy with Toyota, but I want to know what else is out there.
The customer is always light years ahead of any single one of us, right? So any brand that still has a mythology around I can control the customer journey and direct my customer where she or he wants to go is doomed to fail. All you can do is try your best to keep up because she's changing at the speed of light. Every single one of us as consumers adopts things so much faster and with so much more agility than we do as marketers. Right? So think of yourself as a consumer and change your business to fit their path rather than trying to force fit them into yours.
How are you using data to inform your advertising, and how has your definition of advertising evolved?
Yeah, I mean, so we're young. We're a young and restless company for sure, and we're entrepreneurial. So I think we're definitely err on the side of data-informed, not data-driven or data-obsessed. If we were data-obsessed, Chobani wouldn't exist, because the data said, don't create a Greek yogurt company. So it did kind of take someone courageous to say, screw that data, I don't like it. And I can prove that data wrong. So I think the danger in data is, and I've been at Chobani where we had none of it. That's reckless and dangerous, got us in a lot of trouble. I've also been at Chobani where we oversteered and used too much of it, and we lost our entrepreneurial roots and our creativity, and we became like a big CPG company. But that's not who we are. And I think, you know, combination of discipline and rigor, entrepreneurialism, courage and creativity, somewhere in the middle lies nirvana, right? And so it's reckless to not to completely ignore the facts. And I think it's lame to be, to solely rely on the facts. Because anyone can just look at spreadsheets and make a decision, yes or no.
So data and creativity, right? That's the core of why we're all here today, and those are the fundamental questions we're trying to wrestle through. So let me talk very specifically about CBS, right? Because it's a hugely successful company, you know, number one in total viewers of 15 of the last 16 years, et cetera. You can read the stats. I don't need to bore you with that. But we may not do everything right, but this part we know how to do. Right? We have deep, deep, deep investments in all kinds of research and analytics, including the facility in Vegas, but also all kinds of digital, social, AI, and other analytics. And we have extremely successful shows that are watched, you know, by tens of millions every single night. Because we know how to operate. It's not an either or, right? It's not that you have to pick data or you have to pick the creative. That is never the trade-off we have to make.
So one of the things I see in a lot of the firms that we work with, the data people are frustrated. They don't actually get enough time in the C-suite because they don't know how to articulate a clear story around that. And so I don't see that, you know, this data Uber alles that everybody talks about, I don't see that happening in the top companies. They'll tell you they have a lot of data. They don't have enough insights with the data. And so one issue is really you know, how are these people being managed? How much is the intersection between the people who do the data and people who are doing the creative things?
I want to address some specific silos head on, right? So right now, you have data, you have insights, sometimes you have analytics, and they're all over the place, and they're often disconnected from the marketing organization or the programming organization or the sales organization, and that is doomed to failure, right? I have, again, we can all say this. I have never had one of the pure computer science PhDs deliver some awesome insight that transformed a business, because he or she is usually functioning in a vacuum, right? But when you put these people together and you embed them in businesses, but also have the insights, the research, and the analytics people together, and there are data scientists sitting next to a focus group moderator, sitting next to someone who does ratings, then you're on to something, right? And I do think that data has grown in this vacuum at many organizations, and it's very much, to me, yet another methodology in your toolkit. It's not a thing unto itself. And when it becomes a thing unto itself, it's not very successful.
What I've noticed is it's much easier to do this if you're a pure play internet company. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if you're a digital player, this is already happening in a lot of them. The teams are making this. But if you're a standard CPG company, you don't really see that happening. You still see it very siloed. There's a media team, and that's further siloed, and there's all kinds of insights. And you, as you mentioned, the insights team doesn't talk to the shopper team. And to me, it makes no sense. You talk about consumer journey, and the shopper team doesn't talk to the insights team. And then there's the analytics team sitting somewhere else, and you just create this massive, the qualitative people don't talk to the quantitative people. I said, what are the quantitative people doing without knowing what the qualitative thing has been finding out? Why is there not a buildup? Oh, no, we rely on this kind of data, right? This stuff is done with 20 people. Then don't do it if you're not going to use it anyway. So there's no systematic way in which this sort of meets. So I like the idea of people sitting together doing it, but you don't see it very often.
For me, it's simple, right? Know yourself. Know who you are. People call us competitors, right? But Disney's business is fundamentally different from NBC Universal Comcast business, which is completely different from my business. So know yourself. Know what you're good at. Know what your KPIs and what you're trying to achieve. And for us, it's this direct relationship with the consumer. Yes, of course, advertising is wonderful and impactful and meaningful. But at the same time, think about your direct consumer relationship and how you can make the best of that.
Yeah, I'll just end with saying that, you know, consumer centricity is sort of a word thrown around a lot, and, you know, everybody sort of thinks they know what it means in terms of understanding consumers. And I think the key, if you look at the companies that have grown well, they also shape it. So it's not just a matter of understanding. You know, Amazon is not sitting around predicting what e-commerce is going to be like in 2020. They're driving it. But when I talk to the traditional company, they said, oh, let me find out how much is sold in the channel. So I think the shaping piece is really critical, whether it's shaping your point of view, as Peter's talking about. You know, it means you have to have one, first of all, which is hard in a large company that you can get behind. And whether it's shaping preferences, shaping channels, I think there's a lot of, and that's what makes our world exciting, because you can't shape what people think. You know, it's not that people already have a point of view, they're open to arguments and listening, and then they arrive at a view based on what you say and what other consumers, you know, talk to them.